Hello, my dear students. Welcome on board with Vimukti Hettiarachchi. If you have not subscribed me, make sure to subscribe Vimukti Hettiarachchi for English literature and language lessons. Today, I hope to discuss about one of the major poems from your English literature syllabus, that is To the Nile by John Keats. A lot of students find this poem difficult because of the language. So, I like to explain you with the knowledge that I have how to learn this poem and what are the most important parts that we have to pay our concentration when we are going to learn this poem. So if you have not subscribed me, make sure to subscribe Vimukti Hettiarachchi for English literature. So let's get started. So when we start the poem, basically, first and foremost, we should know this poem belongs to the category of sonnets, as you can see on the screen. Sonnet is a 14-line poem where we have 14 lines inside the poem, and basically we can divide sonnets into two types in English literature. Number one, it is known as Shakespearean sonnets. Number two, it is known as Petrarchian sonnets. Now, both poems, both sonnets basically, we have 14 lines. In Shakespearean sonnet and in Petrarchian sonnet, we have 14 lines. But there is a slight difference when it comes to rhyming scheme. As you can see on the screen, when we take Shakespearean sonnet, we have the rhyming scheme. We have three quatrains. Three quatrains means we have one quatrain, we have four lines, right? So the rhyming scheme goes as ABAB, CDCD, EFEF, GG. So the last two lines, we have a rhyming couplet, right? ABAB, CDCD, EFEF, GG. So when it comes to Petrarchian sonnet, To the Nile by John Keats belong to Petrarchian sonnet category, where we have a different type of rhyme scheme. We have octave and sestet. Octave, we have 8 lines. We don't have a quatrain there in the Petrarchian sonnet. We have the octave. Octave, we have 8 lines, right? The next 6 lines are known as the sestet. So the first 8 lines will be the rhyming scheme of the first 8 lines will be A double B A, A double B A, right? A B B A 4, A B B A 4, 8. Then the next 6 lines will be C D C D C D. The rhyme scheme will be C D C D C D. So this grid will help you to understand the rhyming scheme and the sonnet, right? So first and foremost, you have to have an idea what is this poem and why it is known as a sonnet, and in which category of sonnets this poem belongs to. Then we will discuss line by line what is the meaning of the poem and what are the meanings of these lines. Okay, my dear students. So we are moving to the poem. So when we have discussed about the sonnet part. So now you know that sonnet means 14 lines poem, where this poem belongs to the category of Petrarchian sonnets, introduced by Francisco Petrarch. He is an Italian poet. So basically our rhyming scheme is ABBA, ABBA, CD, CD, CD. So as I have explained to you, we have two parts in this poem, right? We have the octave part, first 8 lines, then we have the sestet part. So John Keats has written this poem in order to give two aspects of the Nile River. The first aspect is the mythical quality, or else we call the mysterious quality of the Nile River. This mysterious quality is brought to action using the octave part. Then in the sestet part, he explains about the physical qualities, or else the usual qualities of any river, and he tries to show that Nile River is also just a normal quality of the Nile River is explained in the sestet. So this one you have to understand very carefully, because when we are going to learn about this poem, these two aspects will be very important to us, because even in some past papers I have seen that how they have asked this question from the students, and some students are a little bit reluctant to learn about these two aspects. So you have to remember these two aspects when you are going to study about this poem. What are the two aspects? Number one, octave part tells about the mythical quality of the Nile River, and the sestet part tells about the natural practical elements of the Nile River. Right, let's get started. We will go to the explanation. In the explanation, we will try to understand line by line. So I will take the first two lines, and I will try to explain you. So the poem starts, as you can see on the screen, son of the all moon mountain, chief of the pyramid and crocodile. So this is very important, as you have explained. In the first two lines itself, John Keats has given us the idea, or else the perspective, that you have to see this Nile River as something special, right? So it says, you are the son of the all moon mountain. Right, sun means it is known as a metaphor, right? So metaphor has been used. So Nile River is directly compared to a sun. The all moon mountain range is the
parents of this son. Then palavenima kaviye palavenima adahasa tula rajakaya prakasha karanawa me oba tamai putrayana. Oba tamai putrayana Nile nadiyata kiyenawa oba tamai putraya. Me putrayage demaupiyo wenne me taama parani e kaale sitha pawathagena ena me ape swabhava dharmayata adala vechcha den api oy godak api ahala thiyenawana swabhava dharmaye ස්වභාව ධර්ම ගැන කියද්දි මේ කඳු පන්ති ගැන ගංගා ගැන ගස්වැල් ගැන කියනවා මේ කඳු පන්ති තමයි ඔබේ මේ දෙමව්පියන් වෙන්නේ. ඉතින් ඔබ ඒ කාලේ ඉඳන්ම මේ ලෝකෙ හිටපු කෙනෙක්. So here we can understand that John Keats is referring to the history. Right, we don't know actually whether the Nile River has started when the world began because inside the poem he says about that as well. So in the first line we can clearly understand the eye is a metaphor and you should not forget that the eye is a personification as well. What do you mean by personification? Giving life to non-living things. So here, the word sun is used to Nile River. So we can clearly understand Nile River is taken as the Nile River is personified when it comes to the first line. The writer says chief of the pyramids and crocodiles. What do you mean by this? Now when we take chief, it is again kind of a metaphor used by the poet where Nile River is taken as the leader or the chief or the main figure when it comes to pyramids and crocodiles. So these pyramids are always dealing with this Egyptian civilization. If you read the poem very carefully, we can see they are taken as symbols, because if you read the line very carefully, you can find out John Keats has written the line like this: chief of the pyramids and crocodiles. We are using the definite article the. It explains that crocodiles and pyramids are taken as symbols. So crocodiles are kind of dangerous animals who used to live in this river. So because of you only these crocodiles are living. So the crocodiles are kind of dangerous animals and they are living inside you. So you are also taken as something dangerous. Now this is the part that I have explained to you. Nile River is taken as something mythical, right? So since because crocodiles are also living inside the Nile River, definitely you are a dangerous one. That mythical quality is added there. As well as if you take the pyramids, we should not argue about that. Actually, pyramids are known as one of the most wonderful creations done by the our human beings. So it is actually known as one of the seven wonders of the world. So still some of the scientists can't figure out the architectural methodology that they use to make this type of a beautiful monument. So we have made this beautiful Egypt, or else these Egyptian pyramids, with the help of Nile River. So if you were not there, it will be kind of impossible for us to make this beautiful pyramid. So using these pyramids and using these crocodiles, the John Keats tried to explain us two symbols in order to show the mythical quality of the Nile River. So that part is very important. And here we can see two symbols, and again we can see a metaphor here. Let's talk about the third line and the fourth line. And third line says, we call thee fruitful and that very vile, a desert fills our seeing's inward span. What do you mean by that? Now first and foremost, we can see there are a lot of poetic techniques in these two lines. That is why a lot of students say that it is a little bit hard to understand. We will try to understand the line. The first line says, we call thee fruitful and that very vile. We call thee, right? Thee is known as thee, thou. We can find these words in the poem To the Evening Star by William Blake. So this is known as archaic language. I think you might have heard the word archaic language, where the writer used the word thee instead of the word pronoun you. So you can tell that we call thee, we call you, as you can see on the screen. So we call you fruitful. What do you mean by fruitful? We think that you are something prosperous, right? You are something prosperous. You bring prosperity to this land, something like that. And furthermore, it says, at that very while, the same moment, a desert fills our seeing inward span. Inward span, seeing inward span. This is very important. This is called periphrasis. What do you mean by periphrasis? It is a literature technique that we use in literature, where when the writer is using a set of words instead of using one word to explain some idea. The poet is using set of words instead of one word to explain his or her idea. Now, this seeing inward span refer to imagination. In literature, we call the third eye, right? Normally, we all can't become poets or novelists. What is the reason? We all have two eyes, but they have a special one. They have something called imagination, right? Where we don't have that. We also have that, but we have to improve that, right? So here it says, inward span means we think that we call you. We call you. Again, we have the personification, as I have explained to you, and something called, we call you something prosperous, right? But at the same time, we get the understanding that you also what do you call belong to this desert, right? So in our imagination, we think that this river belong to what do you call this desert. So here we can see another poetic technique which is known as juxtapose. I have explained to you that in this poem we have a lot of poetic techniques. That is why students feel a little bit difficult to understand. Right, in these two lines we can clearly understand. We have the first one, as I have explained to you, the, which is known as archaic language. We call the fruitful. Fruitful means prosperous or fertile. On the other hand, it says that very while a desert fills our seeing inward span. From our memory, from our imagination, we get to know that you are also, even though you are a fruitful river or else a kind of a beneficial one to the people, you flow or else you flow in this desert land. So two contradictory ideas are brought together. This is called juxtapose. What are the two contradictory ideas that we have? We have the desert, the infertile land on one hand. On the other hand, we have the word fruitful. Fruitful and desert, they are brought together. So two contradictory ideas are brought together in literature. That is known as juxtapose. So in line number three and line number four explains about the again, it furthermore emphasizes us the mystical quality of the Nile River. Right, we'll move on to the fifth line and the sixth line. We will try to understand that. In the fifth line, it says, nurse of Swat nation since the world began. So as I have explained to you here, again we can see a metaphor where Nile River is taken as the nurse, who nurse of the Swat nation. Swat nations means these dark complexion people. It can be these Negroes or African-American people who lived in Egypt and other countries. For those people, so it says, nurse of Swat nation since the world began. The very first day the world began, we don't know whether when the world began Nile River was there or not, but poet says that that kind of history is there. Again, we can see how he adds some kind of this mysterious quality to the Nile River. Can you understand? And you are the nurse. With your help only these people survived, right? Nurse of Swat nation since the world began. And furthermore, he adds in the sixth line, art thou so fruitful? Or dost thou beguile? Now here we have again this archaic language where thou means to you, and where we have the other words, beguile. What do you mean by beguile? Enchantment. Art thou so fruitful? Are you really beneficial to these people, or you are just kind of an enchantment? Right? Are you really beneficial to these people, or dark complexion people, or you are just kind of an enchantment or kind of a mystical thing? What do you mean by beguile? Beguile means enchanting, right? Where people will attract it. Right, then furthermore says, such men to honor thee who worn with toil. Such men to honor thee. Again, we have archaic language. Such men means those dark complexion people. They honor you, as I have explained to you. They venerate you. They take you as a holy river. So what is the reason behind that? Because you are actually fruitful. You are providing water for these people, for their agriculture and all other things. Or else, right, you are something enchanting because some kind of mystical quality is dealing with you. What is the real one? So this question is raised from us by John Keats. This is known as rhetorical question. We have another poetic technique, right? Rhetorical question. So this question is asked by the poet, and he does not expect an answer from he does not provide an answer. So he expects an answer from us. Art thou so fruitful? Are you really beneficial, or dost thou beguile? Or you just kind of an enchanting thing? The such men to honor thee. These people are honoring you. These people are give their honor and respect to you. What is the reason behind that? So using a question word, we call that rhetorical question. The writer asks this question. Then the worn with toil. What do you mean by worn? Worn means work, right? Again, we have archaic language, work really hard. Toil means they labor, they really hard, the extreme labor that they have, toil, right? Toil means extremely, they work extremely hard, extreme labor. So that is the idea here which made out. So in here, in this line also, we find a lot of poetic techniques. In the first one, nurse of Swat nation since the world began, we have nurse as the metaphor. And if you take art thou so fruitful thou, we have archaic language, and we have rhetorical question as well, since we have a question mark there. Or dost thou beguile? Again, we have beguile as archaic language. Such men to honor thee. Personification is also used here, using thee, and we have archaic language as well. Who worn with toil, who work really hard. That is the basic idea of the fifth one and the sixth one and the seventh line of this poem. In the eighth line, it explains like this: rest for space twixt Cairo and Deccan. right? What do you mean by twixt? The real word is betwixt. So betwixt means in modern English between, right? It's known as between. It says you your destination, right, is from Cairo to Deccan. So your destination starts from Cairo, and your what do you call destinations end? Destination ends from Deccan. So throughout that destination, I think the Nile River flows around flows through more than 7 countries, more than 7 to 9 countries. So that is why it is known as the longest river, right? So it furthermore explains that what you call the Nile River, it is kind of a trade route between Asia and Africa, right, which connects them together. And from that, the octave part ends and we move to the sestet part. And this shift is done in the 9th line. So in this 9th line is special. Why it is special? Because that change from octave to sestet, that change occurs in the 9th line. So 9th line is known as the volta, right? As you can see on the screen, it is very important to know. The 9th line is known as the volta, right? So where the change occurs from octave to sestet, the poem shifts, right? In the 9th line or in the volta line, we can understand it says, "O may dark fancies earth, they surely do." In the 9th line, the poet changes his attitude towards the Nile River. It furthermore explains that all these mythical qualities, I think they are incompleted, or else we can say inaccurate dark imaginations. I don't think all these imaginations, all these ideas which I have explained about you in the octave part are real. I think most of them are fancies, right? Fancy stories where people have made them. So in the 9th line, the poet tells us, I don't think that all these qualities are real, right? Whether you are the chief of the pyramid and crocodile, whether you are the son of the old moon mountain and the nurse of the Swat nations, I don't believe in those things. I think they are kind of inaccurate imaginations, given to these people about you. I don't think any speciality in you. So now, as I have explained to you, the natural elements, or else the usual elements of the Nile River, is explained here actually, right? So we start to go for the natural elements or the practical elements of the Nile River in the 9th one. Now, if you take these two lines, line 8 and line 9, line 8 explains us about the rest for space twixt Cairo and Deccan, where are the destinations, the two destinations between Asia and Africa as a mode of transport. Started and where it ends. And the 9th line, as I have explained to you, the volta line, where we shift the octave from the sestet, yeah, it says that, "O may dark fancies they surely do." I'm pretty sure that all these stories are about this fancy, right? Or else the kind of a mythical story. So I don't believe in that. So from the 6th line, or else we can say from the 9th line onwards, or else from the opening part of the sestet, we can clearly understand the poet is going to explain about the the practical elements or the usual elements of the Nile River. So this is the first video log to the Nile by John Keats. In the second video log, we will discuss about the sestet part and the target questions for ordinary level examination. So if you like, if you learn something from this video, if you like our videos, please make sure to comment, and please make sure to subscribe us if you have not subscribed us. Vimukthi Hettiarachchi. See you with the next video about the sestet part and the poetic techniques plus some target questions. Thank you so much.